If you'd like to save your health care, you need to listen and pay attention to this retired Marine's campaign video, and then vote for her if you live in the state of Kentucky.
I'm Amy McGrath, and I love our country. I spent 20 years as a U.S. Marine, flew 89 combat missions bombing Al-Qaeda and the Taliban. I was the first woman Marine to fly in an F-18 in combat, and I got to land on aircraft carriers. Now I'm running for Congress against Annie Barr in my home state of Kentucky. He's Mitch McConnell's hand-picked congressman who said he would vote enthusiastically to take health care away from over 250,000 Kentuckians. Mr. Barr, my mom is a polio survivor who became one of the first women to graduate from UK medical school. A lot of people told her she couldn't achieve her dreams either, but she persevered and ended up treating many of the same kind of people whose health care you and Mr. McConnell would take away. This is my new mission, to take on a Congress full of career politicians who treat the people of Kentucky like they're disposable. Some are telling me a Democrat can't win that battle in Kentucky, that we can't take back our country for my kids and yours. We'll see about that.
Please welcome Amy McGrath. Very nice to have you here.
Yeah, it's great to be here.
Yeah, I met you last night at a fundraiser for you because you're incredible, and we need women in Congress, and we need veterans in Congress, and you are a veteran. So how old were you when you joined the Marines?
18. Well, from the Marine Corps, 21, essentially.
And so you were in the Marine Corps for 20 years.
I was.
And then what happened?
Well, at the end of my Marine Corps career, I found myself teaching at the U.S. Naval Academy. I was teaching U.S. government to cadets and midshipmen there. And the 2016 elections were happening, and it became very difficult for me to explain what was happening to our country to my students, who are going to be on the front lines in a few years fighting for their country. And so I decided that, you know, at the end of those elections, I had to do something. I had to stand up. I had to serve my country in another way.
And so you're from Kentucky. You have three small children. What are they, 1, 3, and 5?
That's right.
1, 3, and 5. You have a husband. You're in. You're obviously in a serious relationship.
My husband's a veteran as well.
He's a veteran, right.
We're a dual military family. He was an active duty Navy officer, and I was a Marine officer.
Uh-huh. And you and your husband's a Republican, and you're a Democrat.
He is.
Yeah, that's even better. Mixed family.
You know, that's America.
Yeah, that is America. Exactly.
Eric and I, my husband, we can get along.
Yeah.
It's awesome. You know, we can do this.
So Kentucky is a very red state. And so did you have any reservations about, you're running in the 6th district of Kentucky. Did you have any reservations about that?
No, because my message is it's not about your party. It's about the country. It's about Kentucky. And I really feel like we need leaders who put the country first and listen to their constituents and put the people of Kentucky first. And so in addition, in my district, there's actually more Democrats registered than Republicans. So, I mean, it really is a winnable district for a Democrat.
And I think it's a really important for veterans in particular, because when you have somebody like Donald Trump running the country and all these lives in his hands, I don't know a lot of people in the military, and I am scared to death for them because I don't want him deciding to send our troops anywhere. He's not capable of that decision. And I know on 9/11, you were serving our country. Can you tell us about that?
Sure. So on 9/11, I lived close to Marine Corps Air Station Miramar, which is about 50 miles down the road here. And I was a very junior weapons systems officer in my squadron, so one of the most junior. And I lived very close to the base. I got a phone call from the squadron leadership that said, come on to the base immediately, go into the ready room, and wait for orders. So I did. When I got into the base and I looked around in the ready room, I found out that there weren't a whole lot of other aviators there. There weren't a whole lot of pilots and weapons systems officers. And turns out, I found out later that we went to DEFCON 3 and the gates were closed. And a lot of the other weapons systems officers and pilots lived further away. And so they just weren't able to get onto the base.
What does DEFCON 3 mean?
It's just a measure of security. And 9/11 was a very confusing day. I mean, we remember this. And those of us who were in the military, it was also confusing for our country. And they basically went to a higher security level, so they shut the gates down and didn't let anybody come on base at that time.
And is there, what's the highest level of security?
The highest level is DEFCON 1, and that's essentially like World War III. We haven't been there yet.
Okay.
So that's good.
Yeah,
but we went from, you know, DEFCON 5 to DEFCON 3 on the day of 9/11.
Okay, there's some way.
So I found myself in the ready room, one of the only pilots and our weapons systems officer in there, and my squadron leadership basically looked out and said, we got to man these F-18s. We got to put air-to-air missiles on these things to be the line of defense for Los Angeles and San Diego should there be an airliner coming in to try to destroy the city or people. And so I remember my leadership looking out and thinking, oh, my God, we're going to have to put McGrath in one of these jets. I mean, she's so junior. And him just looking at me and saying, well, go man up. And writing that on the whiteboard with, you know, my name and the jet number and the other pilot and the other weapon systems officers that I was going to be flying with and having to go man up. So that's what we did. We got in the cockpit loaded with air-to-air missiles live.
Wow.
And our job would have been to, hopefully escort maybe an airliner that wasn't listening and then, you know, potentially shoot one down if we had to.
God, my God, that is such craziness. What a terrible time. What a terrible thing to be confronted with.
Yeah, it was very intense.
Yeah, well, it sounds, yeah, it's incredible. So I'm glad that you didn't have to do that.
Me too.
And talk to me about healthcare. Healthcare is a big issue for you, as it should be for every single person in this country.
Sure. Well, it's the number one issue in Kentucky. I mean, what a lot of people don't know is Kentucky really benefited from the Affordable Care Act.
Kentucky benefited from the Affordable Care Act more than any other state in this country.
That's
right. Isn't that right?
That's right. Well, it was one of the top that benefited. And we went from over 20% uninsured rate down to a 5% uninsured rate. That's enormous for a state like Kentucky. And the concern is that we have elected leaders who basically want to sabotage the Affordable Care Act, who want to repeal it, and do it in a way that's going to hurt people and do it for purely BS political reasons. And it's not, you know, this isn't right for Kentuckians. And the thing that I am trying to, you know, explain to people and when I listen to Kentuckians is, you know, they want it to be fixed. You know, there's problems with the Affordable Care. It's not perfect. It was never a perfect piece of legislation. Very little legislation in this country comes out perfect. We know this.
Yeah, right.
You have to tweak it. This is America. No major piece of legislation in our country has ever been perfect. We work on it over time. And so with the Affordable Care Act, we need to work on it in good faith. And that's what I'm saying. Elect leaders who, in good faith, want to fix it and make it better.
And want to help people. So last night we were talking about the Koch brothers, who, you know, are big funders of the Republican Party, and they spend hundreds of millions of dollars on these elections in order to get what they want out of the candidates that they pay to get elected. Mm-hmm. They want lower taxes, they want tax cuts, they want perks for their businesses, they want everything. They are buying their way in. And when people argue that people from Hollywood are giving, we don't know anything about politics, we're giving money to help people. I'm giving money to candidates in different states so that they will, the people that are going to help the people in other states. And your point was, when you get crap for somebody like me supporting you, your response is?
Well, somebody like you, you're not handing me a piece of legislation that says, you know, when you get into office, this is what I need you to do. You're doing this because you want better government. When the veteran in Iowa, you know, a veteran in Iowa donates to my campaign. I'm running in Kentucky. He has no reason to donate to my campaign. He donates because he wants better government. He doesn't want, he's not a special interest. He doesn't want a kickback. And it's the same thing with folks like you. And that's why, you know, I'm not shying away from this.
And then also people who donate, you know, $10. If you have $10, you know, all these people that are running, you know, especially women that are running for, on the right, you know, for the right causes. I mean, obviously you don't just support women because they're women. You have to look into it and find out what causes they support. But when women are supporting the right causes, women are... they're more thoughtful and more compassionate than half of these people that are serving this country. And so when you can donate $10, you know, or $5, it all adds up. So don't think you don't have a say in these things and you can't help this country get somewhere, because it does add up. You said that very eloquently last night.
Well, right. I mean, for me, what I'm really proud of is I have about 11,000 donors. And, you know, about 5,000 of them have donated $20 or less. My opponent, you know, less than, you know, 3% of the funding that he gets comes from smaller dollar donors. I mean, who do you work for at the end of the day? Mm-hmm. Do you work for the interest groups? Do you work for them, or do you work for the people?
Right.
And for me, I work for the people.
Okay, so if you want to donate to Amy McGrath's campaign, you can go to, what is it called?
AmyMcGrathForCongress.com.
AmyMcGrathForCongress.com. Oh, hello. You caught me here in the middle of my own talk show, talking on my show. I hope you enjoyed whatever video of mine you just watched. I know I did. If you want to see more, you can click on that subscribe button, which is, I don't know where it is, but find a button and then click on it, and then just keep clicking, and then suck on that. Okay. Oh, hello.